The SARS coronavirus 2 pandemic has spread rapidly, and the response to slow it down and hopefully stop it has been intense, with social, psychological, and economic costs. Everyone wants to know what the future holds and how this will end. The scientific community is working hard to predict the possible outcomes. Like any predictions, they're more likely to be wrong than right, but they can help us plan and be prepared for the future.
Cases of COVID-19 and deaths are likely to continue to increase for a while. That's horrible, but it is expected. The cases that we are seeing now reflect infections that happened 7 to 10 days ago. The actions that we're taking now to minimize spread won't be reflected in the number of new cases for a few weeks.
This is one of the reasons that testing is such a critical tool in controlling the outbreak. Fast and free access to testing as soon as you start to develop symptoms would help us better understand what is really happening now. We'll be able to get ill people into treatment quickly, which reduces their risk of critical or fatal outcomes. And we'll be able to isolate infected people to prevent them from spreading the virus to others. In China and South Korea, massive testing efforts were successfully put in place. The time from first symptoms to a test result dropped from over a week at the start of the pandemic to one day when they got transmission under control.
We all want the Hollywood ending, where a good-looking scientist discovers a drug and saves the world. But that is very unlikely to happen. Instead, basic behavioral practices like physical distancing and hygiene are our best tools to slow the spread of this outbreak. These tools help minimize the chance that each currently infected person spreads the virus to someone else. This concept, which we call flattening the curve, helps us to keep the outbreak from growing too quickly and exceeding healthcare capacity. Severe and critical cases may need ventilators or ICUs. This outbreak is increasing demand for those services beyond what we anticipated a few months ago, and we need to buy time to ramp up capacity.
We are all making a big investment in our communities by staying home, closing schools, and closing businesses. We are buying ourselves time to set up the testing and health facility infrastructure that will be necessary to keep the outbreak from flaring back up when we start to ease some of our current control measures.
How long will this take? We could make a prediction, but it's likely to be wrong. We should plan for this to take a while. China's outbreak in Wuhan City took 12 weeks to get to zero cases. Their outbreak was only really large in one province. The outbreak in the U.S. is in all 50 states, so we should be prepared for transmission to continue through the summer.
If our efforts do bring the number of cases down to zero, we'll still need to maintain a period of heightened vigilance to ensure that the virus doesn't return. Because the majority of infections are mild or asymptomatic, we'll have to test a lot and wait a while to be sure that it's really gone. Unfortunately, we also need to prepare for the possibility that this virus will be around for a long time. It may even increase again after we've brought it to the brink of elimination.
That means expanding the capacity to test and treat everyone in our community. Testing is the most important priority. If we can detect infection early, then conventional medical interventions can be very successful. In China, the death rate dropped dramatically after the virus was first discovered, as doctors learned how to treat this new disease. We can learn from their experience to ensure a high standard of care here.
What about new drugs and vaccines? New drugs and even a possible vaccine are in development, but will take time to be tested and proven safe and effective. We expect a year or more before these products are ready. And once that is done, they will have to be produced in enough quantity to help everyone and be distributed around the world.
We can look forward to that day in the future. But today, hygiene, testing, and access to traditional medical interventions are our most important tools. All of your sacrifices now are not in vain. We absolutely need this time to strengthen the systems that are keeping us healthy now and to develop the therapies that will keep us healthy in the future.